Thanks for this very generous introduction. It's my great pleasure to be here. I really hope we are going to have lots of interaction and discussion along the themes that I'm going to present. Marco very kindly invited me to introduce a number of topics for this first lecture. But you will see that a number of themes we are going to discuss today are going to be, to a certain extent, foundational for the discussion we are going to have tomorrow, which is more policy focused. And to a certain extent, I will try to introduce a number of ongoing research, also at the very industry-specific case or technology-specific case, in order to engage people like you much more, also on some technical issues that myself as an economist find extremely interesting to understand innovation dynamics. As Marco was saying, I'm an economist as a background, but I spend quite a lot of time visiting factories, talking with people working in R&D labs, and also trying to understand how some of the things they do are relevant for a broader context. The fact that I'm working in an institution which try to address global challenges, and challenges also in terms of development, industrialization, innovation, and so on, makes me really at the interface between the world of economics, engineering, development, and policy. And you will see that a number of things I'm going to discuss and present also draw on a very current discussion around what are the main drivers of innovation, and to a certain extent, how manufacturing systems are changing around the world, and how these affect the industrial competitiveness of nations. So I try to bring some global perspective, but as I said, building on a number of cases or policy issues or documents that have been discussed really across the board. So you will see things related to what type of discussion, for example, is going on at the moment at MIT in a recent project called Production and Innovation Economy. We will see things related to very close, interesting cases of innovation in quite advanced manufacturing system. I will draw on a number of studies, in particular one I conducted on the medical device sector. Okay? And I will try also to give you an idea of how the dynamics of innovative value creation and capture are changing. So at the end of the story, who is making this innovation? And this morning, Marco was giving very interesting insight about, from an historical perspective, of how innovation tend to develop and the different actors involved in these complex systems. The problem is also who is able to capture the value that is generated and how that is possible in manufacturing systems where there are actors who have different functions, perform different roles, and have also different power within these structures. Okay? So I will try to cover all these different things, but I will try to do as much as possible interacting with you and trying to focus much more on really the current discussions in the global context around issues related to innovation dynamics, competitiveness, and so on. So what I'll try to do is to really start with some chart in order to give you a sense of how the global manufacturing landscape is changing. And in particular, I will try to suggest that really we have new actors that are not simply entering into the production realm. But indeed, of course, what is the main countries is becoming the major player in manufacturing production, of course. But not just that, it's also extremely interesting to see how China has been entering into the innovation business. Okay? And I will draw exactly on a study which has been collecting recent data information on why companies like to move to China. And it's not anymore, to a certain extent, related to labor factors, right? That's the usual story, right? Companies move there because they can save some money on, you know, the huge amount of labor and cheap labor. Actually, now companies find China extremely attractive for other reasons. So I will try to start with that, and then I will try to move discussing, well, how all these things at the global level are changing the concern of policymakers and academia when they try to see, okay, if there are these new players, and these new players are involved, not simply in production, but in innovative activities, and are creating more and more value, and are capturing all this value, how this is going to affect us as the traditional industrialized innovative countries. Okay? And I would argue that we are in a very interesting phase where the discussion around these things has been bridging and, in a sense, informing also the way in which we think about innovation. So the second part of my lecture is going to be really trying to discuss how this new debate and the rediscovery on the importance of manufacturing in the context of innovation is changing the overall discussion around the world. Okay? And in particular, we'll try to argue for this reconnection between manufacturing production and innovation on the other side. Okay? So in a sense, it seems that there is a strong emphasis or a tendency to move beyond what was, you know, called for many years a sort of linear idea of innovation, right? You have some crazy people or some R&D labs and they do all the things and whatever it happened later, it's not really part of that process, okay? I will then try to focus on five key aspects that I think are changing the way in which innovative value creation and capture happen. And I will try to not simply remain at the theoretical discussion level, but I will try to give you an example, a very specific example related to a specific ecosystem, manufacturing innovative ecosystem that I've been studying for some time, which is located in a region which is one of the most innovative and manufacturing advanced region in Europe, which is pretty close by in Emilia-Romagna. So the Italians in the room might know that is actually quite a classical case, right? If you read economic test from the 70s or the 80s, people were coming in Italy trying to understand how these regions were able to develop what at that time was called the third Italy model, in terms of how is that they are able to become good exporters of certain products? How is it possible that they are leader in the world in certain specific production niches? How they can be innovative? And also, why is they are innovative if they don't spend too much money in R&D? Which is another paradox of these regions, right? So really, what is going on there? And then I will try to show you a particular aspect that I discover working at the company level in this specific manufacturing system. But it's just one case I could give you, and I will refer to many others, actually, that have been studied in places like the Boston cluster, places like the Cambridge cluster, and so on and so forth. And what I'm going to focus on in particular is something that really shocked me, which was visiting companies. No one really knew that they existed because they were not easy to classify. No one knew if they were medical device companies or automotive companies or robotics companies or software companies. Really strange animals in this ecosystem, okay? But apparently, they were playing a very important role in attracting foreign direct investment, in attracting big multinationals, because they were able to do something that was impossible to do anywhere else. Or at least, they were able to do difficult enough things that were justifying value creation at the local level, okay? Just for those of you who are, just to start creating some appetite, for those of you who follow, you know, all this, you know, world of Ferrari and, you know, Formula One race and so on, I visited a company which is working for Ferrari, designing all the electronics and developing all the electronics for that car, but at the same time is working with KUKA. Is it familiar to you? He's one of the leaders in the world in robotics. And he's working also with medical device companies. Because generally, when you have a complex product, a critical system product like an hemodialysis machine, right? You have, in that case, 1,000, 1,500 components. And these are machines where you go to the hospital, you want to make really sure that the machine is not going to stop because something is wrong, right? You really want to make sure that that thing is properly tested and everything goes in the proper way, okay? So all these things triggered lots of innovations within these companies, because they were facing all these type of technological challenges, and they were also open to lots of cross-sectoral type of innovation. Okay, so we'll focus a bit on that as well. Finally, we'll try to link up all this discussion, again, going back to the global perspective, because at the end, all these innovation dynamics, all these value capture creation dynamics I'm referring to, affect the capacity of different countries to play a role in the world manufacturing landscape. If I ask you, how many countries produce 80% of world manufacturing value added? You know what manufacturing value added is? Basically the total value addition in manufacturing. You know, if you think as economists would do using a standard classification at 2-digit and then 3-digit, you have basically all the different subsectors of manufacturing, right? Chemicals, electronics, whatever. So if you take all that and you take how much is created in each country, right? How much do you think manufacturing value addition in the world is concentrated, if you want to reformulate the question? How many countries really are part of this race? Number of countries? 10? 5? Okay, you are even more negative. No, actually, it's just 20 countries. 20 countries, 5-6 countries capture almost 60%. But 20 countries in the world, and we are going through that, through this discussion now, because there have been quite a few have been entering, right? Probably if I was asking the same question like 10, 15 years ago, 5, 7, something like that would have been a good answer, right? So over the last years, we've been having quite a few countries who have been entering into that, creating value and creating innovation and so on. But it's still striking to see that actually at the end is the story of very few countries. So a big part of the world is not involved in this discussion. And why I'm saying that, because at the end, manufacturing and manufacturing industries, and in particular advanced manufacturing industries, are still the place where the majority of innovation in terms of the type of innovation that create the condition for an innovative economy are created, okay? There is lots of discussion today we're going to see on issues related, for example, to the new German Industry 4.0 or the manufacturing services type of opportunities, you know, in terms of integrating services with new technologies and so on. But the reality is that if you want to integrate services and so on, you, at the end, you need to have this capacity to develop manufacturing products. And very often, manufacturing system products, which means very complex products, which have lots of subcomponents, subsystems, and allow for all these different things. And of course, the more you tend to have a complex product, the more you have generally space and opportunities for innovation. Okay, diversification of the products, of its functionalities, and so on and so forth. Okay, so all this story to say that we will try to get a sense of what is happening at the global level when all these innovation dynamics generate value in different places, and how countries are doing in terms of entering into this global race, okay? And how, to what extent, the world economy is changing as a result of that, okay? Because if more countries enter, of course, into the business of manufacturing production and innovation of new products, diversification of their export basket, you will start seeing an economy which really change, right? It's not just a matter of globalization in terms of culture, in terms of society, in terms of higher mobility and so on, but it's really globalization in terms of what people like to call global value chains or global production networks that become more and more integrated, okay? Okay, let me start then with some charts. I will draw on a number also of reports we've been producing recently. This is one called The Future of Manufacturing. It was produced for the UK government. The UK government got quite scared, right? Because they realized that they're losing quite a lot of their innovation capacity and their manufacturing. So they thought, let's try to investigate and interrogate a number of economists, engineers, technologists, people like us, to get a sense of what are the directions, where are we going, right? What is happening around the world? And one of the things that they were trying to understand is how major players in this game are doing. And their concern was that quite a few traditional industrial economies are actually going down in terms of the amount of manufacturing production, and also you will see in a few minutes, innovation and R&D investment. So the big concern is that there is a global race going on, and this global race really modify the opportunities, the condition for production innovation and manufacturing value addition. And of course, the usual story is that this is happening. Why? Because there is one country who is changing the game, right? And this country is China, as you said. What is interesting from this graph is that when we look at China, so the red line, right? This graph tells you the medium and high-tech manufacturing export in total manufacturing export. So if we have different countries who are all involved in manufacturing activities and export products, right? You want to understand if these countries are becoming more and more innovative and more capable to reach certain quality standards in their product to be able to sell medium high-tech products abroad, right? So if you start basically increasing your share of medium high-tech products in your export basket, it's good news, right? So your economy is basically able to increasingly participate in that part of the race, which is the top part of the race, right? Where there are products with very high value, people involved in the production of these products generally have good salaries, and there is quite a lot of scope for innovation around them, okay? And what you observe here is that a country like China, that at the beginning of the 90s was having less than 30%, 25, 26% of medium high-tech products in their export basket, managed basically to jump at the level of almost 60%. Of course, many of these are subcomponents that enter into complex products. How many of you heard about the usual, now it's becoming a sort of mantra, the iPhone story, who is really contributing to the creation of value, who is part of that value chain? Have you got that story? You know, a number of economists have been trying to look at, you know, one of the icon, right, product icon. And they would like to say, okay, we want to understand who is really making it, right? Many of you have probably an iPhone in your bag or something, or a smartphone or something like that. But in the case of the iPhone, they were trying to see who are the country who are creating all the different components and who is gaining from that. Okay, I'm not giving you the answer because you should go around and search for that. It's a very interesting story, right? But this is one of those products that we would classify as medium high tech, and the different subcomponents are part of that. So the big part of the story is that there is a country, well, this morning Singapore was mentioned, Korea, so a number of countries that Korea in before 1965 was a country poorer than Nigeria or other African economies, okay? They managed to do a fantastic transition towards manufacturing and innovation in 30, 40 years. And many people say, there's a huge literature in economics which studied exactly the example of these countries who managed to catch up and to become innovative and, you know, increase their manufacturing capacities. China is only the last one of these series, right? The famous East Asian tigers, where all countries would actually did exactly what China did in the past. But indeed, Japan was also one of the countries who basically managed to catch up in the last century, right? In a very sophisticated and interesting way. But the point is, we are in this global race. We have all these economies that tend to enter into the race, and we have big players that can potentially change completely the game. What do you expect when a country like China enter the global race? What do you expect in terms of their increase in presence in the world? Well, one first thing would be if they become much more innovative and they become able to produce more, right? And in the case of China, the internal market is still not so big. Things are changing, but you would expect this country to export a lot, right? And in exporting a lot, we'll start basically increasing what? The share in the world manufacturing trade, right? Any company wants to know what is their share in their market, right? They want to know, okay, am I the first, the second, the third player? You know, we can do the same exercise with countries, and then you can realize that China, exactly doing that type of exercise, increasing manufacturing capacity, innovation, and so on, has been basically jumping to an impressive level of control, command of world manufacturing shares. Okay, so that's the first big figure, right? There is a big country which is basically entering into this race and entering into this race and potentially crowding out other countries that were traditionally there, okay? So if we look at the same numbers for countries like, even Japan has been decreasing the contribution share of world manufacturing trade, a country that traditionally is a strong manufacturing country. But there are many others that are not listed here that actually have been experiencing quite a dramatic deindustrialization as a result of the new players entering into many sectors and kicking out the traditional players. How many Italians we have here? Oh, quite a few. So, do you know what is the amount of manufacturing output we lost since the beginning of 2007? One fourth. I think the exact number is around 24 dot something. But the point is that, you know, these are massive transformation. These are really massive transformation. And as a result of that, the concentration in terms of the top 20 manufacturing countries in the world is becoming even bigger than it was in the past. So it's a really difficult, if you want, a difficult race, a place where countries are really fighting hard. There is lots of competition in trying to enter into this manufacturing, and especially medium high-tech manufacturing activities. And what I was trying to say, let me close this first part of the discussion with this, is that not only these countries are entering at the bottom of the pyramid, right? So starting with some, you know, commodified electronics, some t-shirt, and so on. No, they are moving towards innovation, towards more technologically advanced products. And this is reflected also in terms of the amount of investment that these countries are making. These are aggregate figures. And I know myself as an economist find sometimes when you start visiting companies and you start visiting the heterogeneity of sectors, of activities, and so on, you realize that these macro numbers sometimes don't make sense. But to get the first idea, the fact that there are countries like China, but not just China, or Korea and others, that are outperforming the traditional industrialized countries in investment in R&D, is quite an interesting sign, right? Means that this race is not simply having new countries entering at the bottom, but actually countries that are really willing to take part in the technological innovation race, okay? And there are others that seem to not be too much concerned, like Italy, about that. And partially, this is a number which reflects a particular type of manufacturing specialization in Italy, a way of counting for investment in R&D. But nevertheless, there is an issue about how much a number of traditional industrialized economies are investing in the basic foundation for innovation, technological innovation, R&D. The last clear sign, if you don't like these macro numbers, the last real clear sign that something is fundamentally changing comes out from this study, which is called Production and Innovation Economy. So the MIT, as you know, is one of the leading research and university in the world, right? And what is interesting, probably not many of you know, is that all the time the government in the US gets scared about these global trends. They knock the door of MIT and they say, sorry, you have lots of smart people over there. Can you tell us what's going on? So the first time was in the 80s. What happened in the 80s? Well, mid-70s, 80s. What was the big player that was challenging the US? Yes, but what was the country was becoming an important player in manufacturing and innovation? Japan, who said that? Yeah. So at that time, they were fundamentally scared about Japan, right? So they commissioned a study which was called Made in America, okay? And that study was basically trying to address what today we are interested in addressing. So what's going on? So what's changing in terms of innovation, in terms of manufacturing systems, in terms of technological change, and so on and so forth? Why this country, Japan, is actually able to produce now even luxury cars, that for many years the idea that Japan could produce in the 60s, you know, start producing or making effort to produce luxury cars looked like an oxymoron, right? No, come on, they cannot do these type of things, right? Many commentators actually were saying these things at that time. Very recently, when the US was looking at the number I was showing you, and many, many other analyses, just a very quick snapshot, they went again to MIT and they said, sorry, can you just have a look at what's going on there in China? Because it seems that we have quite a few companies that are moving there, and they're not moving there, as I was saying at the very beginning, because they have cheap labor, but because they seem to like to produce there, and to actually, they seem to find their innovative ecosystems, manufacturing ecosystems, that allow them to develop products that we cannot produce anymore here. So they produced this new report. This is the report is actually downloadable, and there are a couple of books connected to that, which is called Production in the Innovation Economy, and the book is called, not very innovative, Making in America this time. The first one was made, now it's Making in America. which was edited by, which has been edited by Susan Berger. And you find within that book, it's very accessible, but is extremely informative about what's going on in Germany, what's going on in the US, what's going on in China. So exactly those major players I was referring to, okay? And one of the main results they found, they compared studies from 96, 97 to those that were done actually later. And they realized that actually China is developing very specific type of capabilities that are critical for innovation. So for example, we'll go back to this, but they find that they are becoming extremely good in terms of scaling up technologies and scaling up production. You are all have a more technical background than what I have. What is this scaling up? Other people use expression like commercialization, or some other people would say scaling up in terms of creating a production line which operates a certain type of regime of, you know, quantity of produced, right? Well, China seems to be extremely good in doing these things. Not only that, but it seems that they are becoming innovative. This morning we were discussing about the introduction bit in the definition of innovation, right? They are becoming very good in doing something which is very smart. There is a huge world out there which wants machine to produce or to, you know, consume, whatever, but they probably don't need lots of functionalities that you find in sophisticated products, right? So what they do? Well, let's get all these machines that are produced around the world, let's reverse engineer them, redesign them, and re-engineer with reduced functionalities. And they have even an expression that we can produce something which has Japanese quality at Chinese price. Right? But the point is not cheap. I mean, the point is not the cheap part of the Chinese price. The point is that they've been doing innovation in terms of redesigning the product and, for example, going to African economies, Southeast Asian economies, Latin American economies, and so on, and saying, would you like to have this product? Is this product really meeting your needs much more than the sophisticated, very high sophisticated, multifunctionality type of product you would find produced in some other more advanced countries, okay? So this is a very interesting change in this panorama, okay? It's not simply anymore there is someone who is trying to become more innovative, entering there and so on. It's changing the way in which innovation happens, right? And is attracting companies that in the past would have not considered to go to work in China, okay? As a result of this dramatic transformation, you would expect that, yeah, with some time lag, the academics start thinking, okay, what's going on? So let's try to understand if this is something that affects, for example, our own economies, our stakeholders. I mean, also universities have stakeholders, right? So we are constantly engaged by with the government or other institution who wants to better understand what's going on, right? Coming to joining actually SOAS, I was in Cambridge, and the place where I was working when I was doing my postdoc was called Institute for Manufacturing, which is an institute which basically tried to develop exactly like you competencies that cut across engineering, technology, policy, economics, governance, institutional type of things, because there is an increasing realization that you have to have all this angle, you know, to understand what is really happening in terms of innovation. And in doing this job, we were constantly engaged by companies who wanted to know, for example, what is happening in Singapore. Singapore, for example, has been attracting companies like Rolls-Royce. You know that Rolls-Royce is considered, or IBM in Vietnam, right? Why does this company want to go there? So they engage academia and try to say, what's going on? Why is that? What do they have there? What are they able to offer there? Okay. So some of the answers that are emerging in this debate are related exactly to one critical connection in the story of innovation, which is the connection between being introducing innovation and producing at the same time. How many of you are familiar with the Lisbon Agenda? Have you ever heard about the Lisbon Agenda? Europeans should know that. The Lisbon Agenda was the agenda that was informing innovation policy in Europe during the last decade. Okay, if you're not, well, this, what this agenda was basically saying, that Europe had to become a knowledge economy, okay? And what that means, well, that fundamentally should become much more innovative, should, you know, stop doing lots of things that used to do in the past, producing steel, all these boring things, they would have said, and start becoming innovative in not well-defined, but in sectors where there is much more innovation, right? Many were saying, you know, we even don't need to have so much manufacturing home, because frankly, you know, all doing all these manufacturing dirty factories, we can leave them to some other countries like China, that actually was pretty happy to get quite a few of them. Now the things are changing, and in particular, this study has been challenging this position, so the commonly held notion that simply investing in upstream innovation and R&D will automatically lead to prosperity that benefits the nation as a whole, which in other terms means is challenging the idea that innovation comes out simply from, as I said before, you know, some companies having an R&D lab and making lots of investment there, or the government financing lots of universities and so on. But actually, it's much more complex than that. And the reality, and again, I'm quoting this MIT study, prosperity, or if you want, innovative manufacturing activities, only emerge when innovations are translated to a stream of new products and services, which are then scaled up in a way that creates jobs and opportunities for the world population. In other terms, is exactly that link that also Marco was mentioning this morning, right? You need to have a market, you need to be able to target that market, you need to create a business model for that market, and you have to become able, especially in a very competitive international environment, to come out with a product which has reached certain quality standards, and it's relatively cheap. I mean, think how many of the things that we have, how cheap they are, in relative terms, right? Laptops or all things that we, you know, until 5, 10, 15 years ago, oh, these are high-tech stuff. Now, are almost commodities, right? You can buy them in a very simple way, right? So the point is that it's a very complex race. It's a very complex game. And these studies are pointing to something that has been changing around the possibility of being part of that race, which means that probably it's no more true that you can do innovation just focusing on these parts, but you actually need to find parts of the, if you want, innovation cycle or linear innovation cycle, whatever, but you need to think very carefully about the manufacturing systems when these innovations happen, and think in particular about how your companies in the economy are able to address what I called before scaling up challenges. In particular, it seems that the relationship between manufacturing and innovation is particularly critical when we look at this issue of scaling up, which means having a certain type of idea and moving this idea, developing a new technology, a new product, a new business model for that, and then being able to manufacture that product. Okay? Lots of the products that we have on that we use commonly were not taught as they are, right? But they had to be constantly adjusted and transformed because at the manufacturing stage, the producers realized that it was not possible to do what the innovator, the inventor, whatever you want to call him, was or her, wanted to do. Okay? So there is a fundamental link here that has to be part of our understanding of innovation and how innovation can happen. Have you ever heard about this guy called Gary Pisano? He's another star in the business, industry, innovation type of literature. He wrote this article in 2009 in the Harvard Business Review and wrote a book called Producing Prosperity with MIT again, where he basically started visiting companies and he started looking at technologies and products that in the US were possible, I mean, were produced in the 90s and 2000, and he was trying to see, do we still have the competencies to produce them? What do you think they found? Actually, they realized that for many, many products in the US, it's not possible. They don't have anymore the production capacity, the manufacturing capacity, and the scale for producing quite a lot of products that are important products in the international trade context I was showing you before. Even worse, they realized that the fact that they lost these competencies in manufacturing is reducing their capacity to innovate. So in other terms, there is increasing evidence that the countries that tend to be more innovative are also those countries that in a selective, you know, strategic way have been able to maintain those companies that are able to do those critical activities that are not simply related to the innovation in the traditional sense we taught for a long time, but actually that are able to manufacture at a certain specific scale and with certain specific characteristics products. Okay? The interesting thing is that given the extreme complexity of many of the products that we have now, it's never a matter of one company. As Marco was mentioning this morning, there are different companies that participate to the production of any of products that we have, right? Is what the economists used to say, vertical disintegration, which means we don't have anymore the Fordist factory, right? We do everything in a long production line and we assemble everything, we do everything there, right? But actually there is quite a lot of networks that produce a final product, and each company within that network contribute with different components, parts, activities, functions, and so on, right? So all the literature around global value chain is around basically trying to understand this phenomenon, right? Of vertical disintegration, right? Now, if to produce complex products or products that, you know, allow countries to and companies to get quite a lot of value, to create value and capture that value, is no more a matter of a single company, but the companies rely on many others, right? And we have just said that they need to have within this system also quite a lot of manufacturers who know how to produce the things, right? Who can tell back to the innovators, no, this cannot be done, or this is not commercially viable. On this idea, no, I'm sorry, we cannot basically make that thing happening. If you don't have all these actors, your capacity to innovate is basically affected, right? This study introduced a concept that has been quite popular and became quite important in the discussion around how innovation is happening now and how manufacturing systems are transforming. They introduced the idea of commons, industrial commons. You know what is a common? It's basically when you go and visit, for example, a cluster, right? And you visit a company and they tell you that actually the guy who you are interviewing was working with the company, which is opposite the road, right? And that indeed they know exactly where they can find within the cluster or within that small region, depends on the size of the manufacturing system you're looking at, they can actually find exactly the guy, the specific contractors of companies who are able to do that last part of the process, that are able to even downstream type of activities, are able to provide MRO services, are able to provide any type of... The fact that there is all this knowledge, and this knowledge is sort of shared among a number of actors that are part of that ecosystem, this is basically a collective value that all these actors are sharing, right? Why is that in the world activities are all clustered? Why everyone is obsessed with the Silicon Valley, of the Boston area, as was mentioning, you know, the Cambridge, Oxford, I lived for many years around Cambridge, the Cambridge-Oxford sort of European Silicon Valley. Why is there is all this clustering? It's exactly because this manufacturing ecosystem developed in a way which have a fundamental, offer the companies who are there, a fundamental competitive advantage, right? Because they can actually find exactly what they need, right? For being more innovative, to produce, to reach quality, to reach markets, and so on and so forth. So what this paper was suggesting, and many other studies, I'm just using this as an example, is that the fact that in the US, lots of this manufacturing ecosystem has been basically destroyed by the fact that many companies have been leaving all around, this is fundamentally changing their capacity to be innovative. So they don't have any more that industrial commons they were used to rely on in the past. And part of this industrial commons is what? It's also, as Marco was mentioning this morning, having a government who makes investment, right? So in the paper, they try to track how much the US government has been declining in terms of investment in basic research, right? So in this ecosystem, in these areas I was saying, you know, these clusters and so on, often there is an R&D lab financed by the government, there is a university which forms and trains certain type of people, and so on and so forth, right? So the fundamental problem is that innovation is changing, and the complexity of the products make the link between innovation and production even stronger, even more important. In other terms, some people use this expression, you know, we have to think about innovation as if it is a sort of cycle in where it's very difficult to understand where you start and where you end. Because at the end, you have lots of different actors that perform all these different activities and make the other, the innovators in the traditional sense, make them possible to do what they do. Okay? Not only we are changing our way we understand the relevance of this ecosystem, and I will give you an example, as I said, as an industrial case, so that you can get a sense of what is really happening on the ground. Actually, let me do this exercise. You come from different countries, right? Do you have any case of interesting clusters of areas around, for example, your university or around in your country where clearly that's the part of the country which is generating more innovation, more transformation, and so on? I give you examples, right? When we talk about Italy, people look at the traditional industrial regions, Piedmont, or Lombardy, or certain parts of Emilia-Romagna, certain parts of Tuscany. Any other idea from other countries? Have you ever been trying to see where all these products are produced, right? And how is that very often they come from 3, 4, 5, 6 regions within a country, and the rest is not really part of that activity? Well, think about it, because the issue is that behind each of these interesting products we all like, right, there are specific regions who have become able to develop over the years a specific competitive advantage in producing subcomponents of products, in dealing with some advanced materials, in dealing with integration of certain technologies, and so on and so forth. Okay? So there is quite a lot of these cases that can be used to actually capture a fundamental driver of what is happening, a fundamental characteristics of what is happening around, right? Which is never a matter of homogeneous transformation, homogeneous type of activities. It's always a matter of specific areas that are sort of hubs of innovation. Not only I was saying we are thinking increasingly about innovation in this way and thinking about these manufacturing ecosystems and how innovation happened within them, we are also changing the matrix that we use to understand innovation. Which means that if it is the case that production and innovation are so interlinked, right, we need to have metrics, so a way to measure, understand all these different activities and how they are related to each other. So in the current discussion, for example, in Europe, people are adopting increasingly a metrics which is called technological readiness levels. Have you ever heard about it? Yeah? Can you tell us what this is more or less about?
Is there like an index explaining how much a country is prone to be technological?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. Exactly. So there is an issue of trying to measure or get a sense of where you are when you look at a certain technology and you look about a certain country in these ecosystems. You wonder, is this ecosystem able to come out with the final product? Or, in other terms, is able to, has enough responsiveness to, for example, a market request of a new type of activities, invention, whatever, product, and so on and so forth. And these actually were developed, these metrics are not new, now are becoming new, right? I mean, are presented as new, but actually, they were used in the aerospace industry in the US from the 70s, 80s. In other terms, all the time you have something which is complex, like you know, producing an airplane, right? Clearly one of the products in the world which has more components in the world, right? You need to do an assessment and create metrics which allows you to understand the readiness, so the capacity to respond to specific needs that you have in the full technological innovation process, okay? So in other terms, you see that people are using this type of sort of thermometers or metrics, right? Which basically says, in order to go from the basic principles and basic R&D activities, we have a long journey before something becomes a real technological innovation. If you think this morning, Marco was showing you an horizontal version of the same story, right? Which is basically the, when he was showing you the challenges that companies, in general ecosystems, face in going from the basic research, you remember that graph? The basic research on the one side, where the government is more present, and then the last part, where industries tend to be more present. Well, this is the same story. Actually, companies like to work at this level. They like to have, basically, the possibility to transform a number of new technologies, new components, new prototypes, new prime series in a potential new product, right? But to reach this point here, you actually have to go through all these other stages, which are, as Mark was mentioning this morning, very risky, requires huge investment both in the basic research and in the first standardization and first activities associated to innovation. And is there where an important part of the innovation process happens, right? So this is exactly the point that people are saying we should look at these parts carefully, and we should think about how having specific manufacturing competence allow to move from the TRL 1 up to TRL 9. This is exactly the areas that are becoming central in the discussion of innovation. So for example, in the European context, people probably heard about the so-called valley of death. Anyone heard this expression? It's the idea, as Mark was saying this morning, that there might be a first phase where the government universities make investment. They take, they socialize risk, if you want, because the government is basically getting money from the collectivity and make investment that otherwise no one would do. And then the private sector, as I was showing before, these are the same readiness levels I was mentioning before, and then the private sector like to jump in, right? What's inside here? What is in the middle? There is a phase where there is lots of testing, lots of prototyping, lots of activities that the private sector sometimes don't want to do because it's very risky, maybe, you know, just a waste of money. And on the other side, the government and universities tend to relatively, especially the old way of thinking about innovation, to finance less. Okay? Because with few exceptions, like the two polytechniques here, but in general, universities are not exactly fully able to go through all these critical stages here, right? And they work in a different way, right? They don't have the time and the sense of the market that the private companies might have, right? So in other terms, in this new way of rethinking about the importance of link between production and innovation, the role that manufacturing systems play in supporting innovation dynamics, there is also an increasing interest in trying to look at metrics and ideas that allow us to identify in a more targeted way where problems are, where problems might arise that might hinder our effort to be an innovative economy, to be an innovative firm. Okay? So now it's really time to we've been trying to set the problem, right? This big transformation at the global level, this pressure, that competitive pressure, that to a certain extent is positive because it allows to have more players into the game that actually transform the geography, not only the, you know, the production engineering side of that, but the geography of spaces, right? Many areas where there are innovative clusters are transforming completely what is around them, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of people they can attract, and so on and so forth. Again, the example of the UK is astonishing. I mean, if you visit the UK, when you are around the triangle London, Cambridge, Oxford, or the southeast, which is actually the only part of the country which is growing, which and has been able to recover after the crisis, it seems to be in a completely different place than you go up in the north or in other parts of the country where actually there are no manufacturing ecosystem, innovative ecosystem, and there are very few companies, very often, you know, small niches or small activities, that are not able to generate this ecosystem as we were describing before. So in other terms, they don't have all these industrial commons around them, which allows them to be constantly innovative and able to be part of the international race. So now, the point is, we have these contexts, we have these challenges. What do we know about the innovative value creation and value capture dynamics that actually characterize this manufacturing system. Because at the end of the story, both countries and companies are interested in making innovation, but innovation that allows to create some value, and also create a value that they can capture in the sense that they can have a return from that, right? What might be the returns from an innovative companies at the country level? If you're in a certain region, what you would expect? Any idea? Very good. So the first thing is, the first channel through which an innovative firm is contributing to a certain area, right, is creating, changing the amount of employment, employ more people, but also employing better people, right? Because you need to have better in the sense, sorry, let's not confuse the, better in the sense of people who are better trained or that are more involved in an activity that is not a routinized activity, but activity that requires quite a lot of constant learning in the process, right? This is what, for those of you who are coming from Turin, is what Adriano Olivetti was doing, transforming Ivrea. You know who is Adriano Olivetti? Oh, great. Anything else apart from employment?
Paying taxes.
Paying taxes, yeah. So contributing actually to that process, right? Because the taxes are also those resources that I use to invest exactly in that basic research and activities and train people and so on and so forth, right? Someone else said services. What type of services? Yeah, I mean, having innovative economies requires that infrastructures are built, requires and contribute to that type of process, right? That a number of services, different type of services, are connected to that, right? Even the word services, right? Services can be very different, right? You can have sort of low quality services, but if you have a company which is innovative, generally requires quite sophisticated producer services. This is an expression that has a specific content because there is an increased attempt to identify numbers which tells us how much services that are of the type, so producer services, are actually developing in the countries. Indeed, when in the past many of the sophisticated producer services were within manufacturing, we're not even considering them services, right? There are lots of companies now that they do specialize in design or other activities, right? Again, the UK is one of the countries that produce more design engineers for the automotive sector, right? And you have lots of companies who provide services of this type. These engineers in the 60s would have been employed within a manufacturing companies, right? And the value generated from that would be called manufacturing value added. Now, it's part of another classification, because the way in which the manufacturing system has evolved and transformed has created these new services as a result of the changes in the way in which manufacturing system work and innovation happen, right? And of course, you can get, you know, backward-forward type of linkages that are attached to that company, right, in terms of services or other type of components and so on. So quite a lot. So an innovative firm can transform, working within this ecosystem, completely the space where they operate. But there are also companies who try to enter into this business of technological innovation, but not necessarily are able to capture the value that they generate. Why is that? Well, in order to capture the value, right, which means you are creating a very good component, you are making a part of a machine or a product or something which actually makes that product what it is. Without that, it would not be possible to have that product, really. You would expect that company is going to get the big part of the total value of that product. This is not always the case, right? And this is not always the case. Why? Because exactly in that transformation of manufacturing systems, you have different companies that play different roles, right? You might have a big company which has big shoulders and can actually try to go around to find innovative small companies that have very good ideas but don't have the financial capacity or they don't have the position in the market to fully exploit that, right? So they might be the place where value is created, But the commercialization, the manufacturing of that can be in the hands of other companies, right? So understanding where value is created, where value is captured, at the company level or at the country level, is a way to really understand how innovation dynamics can transform companies, allow them to survive, to reproduce, to go through different stages of technological innovation, diversify, but also allow to understand what are the countries who are benefiting most from the presence of these companies, right? As we were saying before, having an innovative company and an innovation ecosystem allow your country to be fundamentally different. You just have to visit the Emilia-Romagna region and see how different it is, for example, from, I come from a region, is Abruzzo, is in the center of Italy. There is some manufacturing, but there is some innovation, but not really. And the place is fundamentally different. The geography of the place, the infrastructures, the quality of education, the quality of the overall economic system. Okay, so this is a critical issue to understand. Is it a new idea? This idea that manufacturing is the main, a manufacturing system, innovative manufacturing system are the main drivers of an economic system. Is it a new idea? Have you ever met this guy? This is in the 20 pounds. Do you know him? Anyone from the UK? Okay, we have Adam Smith here. Yeah. Yeah. So on the back of the 20 pounds, there is something which says the division of labor in PIM manufacturing and the great increase in the quantity of work that, I never remember that, something. But the issue is, refers to the advantages that the division of labor, which means the creation of manufacturing system, allow to an economy when it happens, right? So increasing specialization, the increasing introduction of sophisticated machinery that execute a specific task and so on. So this is an old story indeed. All the Industrial Revolution has been basically a story of creation, emergence of regions that were able to become innovative, use new technology in production in different ways and transform the place where they were. Someone else has been thinking about these issues in the mid of the 19th century. Do you know who is him? He's a guy called Charles Babbage, and he's the first one who thought that actually these engines you all have and we all use are quite a smart idea. He's the first inventor of a computer. He was a professor of maths in Cambridge, but was also someone who was interested in understanding the transformation of the manufacturing system in the mid-beginning, first part of the 19th century. He has a book in 1932, which was basically trying exactly to understand the transformation of the manufacturing system in the context of the Second Industrial Revolution. So these are not new ideas. The guy had the problem. He wanted to make this machine, right? This first sort of calculator. By the way, it's still exposed in the Science Museum in London. The problem was that in order to do that, he had to leave his lab. He could not remain just at university thinking about how this machine could be designed. Why is that? Because he never produced anything. I mean, he had to go around, literally, visiting shops and asking manufacturers, producers, innovative people, how the hell I'm going to make this machine working? What type of components I need, how they're going to be, this is happening, and so on. And actually, in doing that, he discovered that the manufacturing system was changing. He's the first one who, in the 19th century, started talking about innovation policy and innovation system. So many of the indicators that today you see, you know, when they talk about, oh, is this country innovative? Let's see the number of engineers or the number. The guy was collecting this number for the UK, and even at that time, he was quite worried about it, okay? In the same way, okay? So many of these ideas are not new. They change in a way over time because we are facing with different type of technologies, with different type of economic systems, and manufacturing, the way in which manufacturing is organized, change constantly over time. Actually, his book was important for economists, even more than for engineers, and you know why? Because Karl Marx, in order to understand the capitalism and the new division of labor, had to read Babbage. Actually, if you read chapter 13 in this capital, in the division of labor, in a note it says, this is all information that I got from this guy. The story of this guy is very interesting. I mean, there is also a great woman on the back of him, his wife, who was actually designing the algorithm to have the functioning of this machine functioning. And actually the first name of the internet system in the US took the name of his wife because it was actually inspired by some of the things that at that time, you know, they were thinking through. But that's a long story. But the point here is that there is this problem of understanding innovation in manufacturing system has been there since the beginning of industrialization and the emergence of a new capitalist system. Okay? Now let's try to think about what, you know, in many reports, or this is, comes from the Industry 4.0 from Germany, what in many reports today is described as a manufacturing system and how innovation happens within them in terms of, as I said, value creation and value capture dynamics. The US has been one of the countries that has been able to, over the years, actually to make quite significant contribution in understanding this transformation. There is an institution called National Standard Institution, the NIST, which has actually had quite a number of economists and engineers working together to try to understand how manufacturing system today, from the time of Babbage up to today, has been changing, and in particular, what should be known about these changes, this transformation. And fundamentally, if you read the work of Gregory Tasse, in particular, I would recommend there is a book which collects a number of his contributions from 2007, published by Edward Elgar, called The Manufacturing Imperative, which basically tried to address exactly some of the issues we are discussing now, how innovation happens in these new manufacturing systems. And fundamentally, one of the key messages that he developed there is that modern manufacturing systems consist of very complex interdependencies, often across a range of industries. This means that many of the numbers that economists generally use for understanding sectoral innovation, sectoral activity, sectoral value addition are quite problematic, are becoming increasingly problematic. And all these different industries that are all, you know, interdependent, symbiotic, in a sort of symbiotic relationship, contribute a variety of components, materials, production system and subsystem, producer services and product-related service systems. So in other terms, we are facing really, when we say manufacturing system is not just a nice expression, we are really, there is as you know, there is a real branch of engineering science that try to address actually how it works, from the operation within a company up to the way in which these operations are integrated across companies and across sectors. And the second aspect is that the mode of production, so the way in which the manufacturing system works and production is happening, is actually increasingly orchestrated by a number of, if you want to call them, in some literature they are called system integrators of big multinational companies who actually orchestrate very complex first, second tier supplier chain that actually are able to put together different numbers of components and make innovation reaching the market. Now, the issue is, how do we capture this? Because it seems to be basically saying, oh, this is very complex, there are lots of actors, they seem to be all interacting. Yeah, but, I mean, do we have a theoretical way to think through that? Some analytics that allow us to start cutting, decompose this system, this complex structure, right? There is another famous scholar called Herbert Simon. Have you ever heard his name? He made a contribution actually in artificial intelligence, apart from being one of the main thinkers in economic theory. And one of his papers is called The Architecture of Complexity. And he talks about the problems of decomposition of a system, right? So in other terms, we need to, when we have a complex structure, find a way to decompose that and try to understand the different layers, the different components, how that works, and the dynamics of that, right? So the point is basically, we have a manufacturing system where innovation is happening, as we were saying. All these manufacturing systems are located in different regions, in different countries. We have different actors involved. Now, how we repackage all these things? Well, a way to do that, we've been trying to explore different models of that. And one could be, for example, trying to start from, if you want, from either from the bottom or from the top, either from the micro firm level and the technologies, or from the, this sort of global chains that actually are becoming the main places where production happen, innovation happen, and activities are orchestrated, and try to decompose these different dimensions and think about what are they and what, how they matter in the context of innovative value creation and value capture dynamics. So let me try to explain that, but I will give you a concrete example so these things will not remain just words, right? Economists like to develop theories, right? So we tend to create lots of big castles and then sometimes they don't. But actually we have, I will try to show you that we can actually populate this concept with specific type of things that are drawing actually from lots of engineering knowledge, okay? So let's start from the top, right? So at the moment we have in the world a number of sectoral value chain, which means a number of sectors are structured as value chains. These value chains are, you are familiar with the concept of value chain, right? Are you? Yeah. So many of these value chains build on different companies, right? That are located in different areas, right? And are constituted by different functions, right? In each stage of the value chain, there are one or more companies that is performing specific functions, right? I will go back and will show a typical representation of a value chain in a second. Now, if we think about these value chains, there are companies who are not part of, and generally almost all of them, are not part of just one value chain, right? The example I was giving you before, there might be a company which is working in the medical device sector and working also in the automotive sector value chain. So these value chains, indeed, they're overlaps, right? There are lots of overlap between them if we look at the companies. So there is an operational layer which is related to these sectoral value chains and all their overlaps. There is an organizational layer which is related to the way in different regions all these companies work together. And there is a layer which is actually, in order to do what they do, innovate, produce, and so on, they use different set of technologies, right? And this is something that engineers know much better than economists, because economists tend to have just one expression, technology, that's it. But actually, there are different variety types of technologies, and they contribute to the innovation process in very different ways, right? So let's try to think about the fact, and if we use this as an heuristic, that we have, you will see this in a bigger version with real, you know, meaningful expression inside, but there are typical value chain, some of them overlap, so there are connections between some of them. For each of them, we have different stages, and we have a list of different functions that are performed. And who is performing them? Well, there are different companies that do different things, right? And each of them rely on different set and system of technologies that make them able to operate in a specific way, all these different functions, and work across different value chains, okay? So that's a first, relatively simple way to think about a system, we decompose it, and we think about all these different dimensions. And I will show later that actually all these different things have been helping us quite a lot in unpacking a number of production system of manufacturing ecosystem and understand where innovation was coming from, where technologies were developed, where they were used, and so on. I'll skip this because this is more, if you want, the economic perspective around these issues, which actually goes back to the work of the first person who used the expression, or indirectly, the expression of capabilities, right? The expression of capabilities, something or competencies, that are used generally in engineering type of context, right? Economists generally don't like that, but indeed, we have a full theory of the firm, which actually have been building these ideas around technological, organizational, production capabilities, has been trying to explore some of the things that we are discussing now, which means how companies identify productive opportunities, how they combine and recombine capabilities to get an innovative product, to get an innovative technology, and so on and so forth. And of course, there are also Economic theorists have been studying this phenomenon that I was referring before of companies organizing and working together in different ways to create value. Now, in this complex system, and you are all familiar with value chain, the problem is that value is created no more in a very simple linear way, where there was one company which is the innovative one, and that's it, right? And there are some others that are less innovative and so on. But indeed, within each value chain, value is created and nested in a specific part of the value chain, right? Which means that there are a number of functions that do not require very sophisticated activities, and others that actually require sophisticated activities that have lots of scope for innovation, and is there where the value generally is concentrated, is nested, okay? So if you think again, if you start from one of the products that we like, and we think about where is the value coming out, we take, you know, the standard iPhone or Apple, whatever, what is really the value created there? What are the parts of that product that to be produced require quite a lot of investment in technological innovation, investment in manufacturing scaling up, and so on and so forth. And if we are able to identify what they are, then we are also able to understand where value is nested in that value chain, right? Because there might be 10, 15 companies that are participating to the production of that complex iPhone or whatever it is, but only some of them are really making the big value out of that, right? Think about the fact that the smartphone technologies, right, was the winner and was the loser of the smartphone industry. You are too young for all to remember that Nokia was a big player, right? Nokia had some small problem, well, a big one, almost they had to sell their headquarter building a couple of years ago. Why is that? Well, they, you know. Yeah, but what, if you now, yeah, it's fine, but what part, what they were missing? If you think about the components that were entering, it enters now smartphone. Yeah, so they had problems with one specific part, which was difficult to do or difficult to reproduce, right? And there were others who actually were pretty good in doing that, and they managed to jump into that, and Nokia had to reposition himself, right? We could start talking about, you know, the relationship with Ericsson. We can talk about the way in which Apple has been entering into that, or Samsung now is actually working exactly on that part of the complex product, right? So when we think about products, we cannot just think about the product that is innovative, right? But where, what is the well, there is nothing here innovative apart from the design. What is actually making that product complex, innovative? What are the components that are difficult for companies to do? So all the time we start opening these products, right? And then we see what are the parts, what are the technologies, what is the real innovation, and we link that to specific companies, and we link these companies to specific places, then we actually start learning a very interesting story, which is the story I was making since the beginning, which means that all these different fortunes in the global manufacturing race depends at the end from these very simple things, okay? Which means depends on the fact that certain regions are able to do certain type of things, that enter in successful products, and they're able to create value which is nested in that part of the production process. In this case, you know, the creation of this touch screen or whatever it is. So value is nested in this value chain. And the fact that things are, I've been saying more times, difficult to do, what is the difficulties there? It's very often in, for example, in the case we were saying before, you, in order to produce that component, you need to integrate quite a lot of complex technologies, right? So you need to have a number of complementary capabilities along different type of area, technology areas, right? For those who like the expression of key enabling technologies, which is very popular again now in the European context. This is a concept we will see tomorrow that has been used for basically identifying the main technological areas where we think manufacturing is going in the future, where we think there is more innovation, or where we think that the big the products of the future are going to be built. So in this specific type of technology domains, we have, again, subsystem of technologies and so on. But in order to use them and to benefit them in the different industries, you also have to, always have to integrate many of these technologies. Today, for example, we see tomorrow a case of a packaging industry, machine, producers of packaging machine in both food and pharma. They have fundamentally to integrate two big areas of engineering technologies, mechanics and electronics, right? So big mechatronics type of application, right? So in other terms, all the time you have sophisticated products and you are able to capture value, the more there is difficulties in this type of integration, the more you tend to capture and create more value, and less are the companies that are able to be part of that game. Think about all the products, the more sophisticated products we like today, are not produced by many companies, right? The smartphone industry is quite concentrated to a certain extent, right? Because there are relatively few are able to do certain things, right? I will come in a few seconds on a medical device industry. That's another area where you have complex machine that perform very critical activities, critical because they're indeed called critical system products, but because they basically integrate advanced materials, they integrate embedded software, they integrate traditional mechanical parts, they have to integrate lots of different things, okay? So that's the fundamental issue. Based on this structure and possibility for value creation in these value chains, companies can follow different diversification paths, right? So if I'm able to develop a specific set of competencies, which means technologies, in a specific areas, right? What do you expect? That company, as we were saying this morning, in the case of our Edison friend who was trying to move from one market to the other, right? In that case, he was trying to explore different markets or different potential clients, right? But at the same time, you can have companies who try to enter in new completely value segment products or completely different new products or different sectors. Well, Google is doing something with the car at the moment, right? That's a quite an interesting example of a company that in the past no one would have said, you know, is going to be part of a sector which, I mean, they don't have any mechanical company. Why they should go there, right? But when a car becomes a product system that depends, is fundamentally controlled by very sophisticated, if you want, control system sort of like a human being, right? All the neurons going all around the car trying to capture information and return information to the car itself about, you know, the driving condition and how the driver used the car and so on and so forth. Then at that point, being very good in controlling the type of technology domain allows you to become a player in that type of industry, right? So you can have this type of diversification path, and not all of them have the same space for value creation, right? You can have diversification paths that do not really allow you to become a new major player, right? Think about all the white goods industry, right? Electrolux, have you ever visited any white goods industry? They basically produce almost everything you can get in a kitchen, right? But very often the type of technologies that they use are very similar, very, you know, a close cluster of complementary technologies, and they diffuse them. But in doing this type of diversification, they're actually just trying to enter different markets, but the opportunity for innovation and value creation are much more limited than in the case of products that tend to be more sophisticated, or in the case we were saying before, where a company is actually entering a completely new domain. Okay? So there are different possibilities there. What is interesting is that all companies who are part of a sectoral value chain, who are doing all these activities, who are trying to diversify, who are trying to get new innovation, in order to do that, what they do is to basically try to think about, well, areas where they have competencies, and trying to see if the type of competencies that allow them to do certain type of activities can be combined, recombined to actually move to higher value segment of the value chain, right? This is a typical representation of the value chain, which also it was called smiling curve, right? It was the idea that there was a sort of value concentration on the two extreme side, which means the side of the R&D innovation activity and the part related to retailing, distribution, post-production services, and so on and so forth. This is a Probably you saw this before, right? Because now a value chain with this type of form appears in The Economist, any type of journal, right? When they try to say this is an industry, there is a value chain structure, and always use this type of representation to say that if you are here, if you just do manufacturing or some assembling, actually you are not going to get too much out of it, right, in terms of value. Indeed, people exactly that are trying, I'm coming to you, that are trying to challenge, I was saying before, the story around innovation today, are criticizing also this value chain representation. And why is that? They are criticizing that because here the assumption is that fundamentally value creation in the part of manufacturing is pretty limited. So they are saying, look, this is not really the case. This is a quite rough representation of what value chains are in terms of value creation. If you think about a value chain at the moment, more than looking like a smiling curve, is much more a curve which actually goes down but then has lots of peaks, which means that there are lots of opportunities for creating and capturing value, also in the manufacturing stage, exactly for that story I was saying before. If you are able to produce that touch screen, right, and the production of that is complex, then you will have a peak here, which basically allows you to capture more value and create it. Please. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, in the global value chain literature, the value is fundamentally related to, if you take a product, to the final market value of that product, and to what extent the different actors that produce that, I have a share in that final value. Okay. Now, the problem is that the final value of that product is decided by the market, right? So not necessarily reflect, if you want, the embedded amount of capabilities, competence that are required to produce that, right? And this is why certain type of companies might get more value than what is their real contribution to that product, right? But fundamentally is, if you want, the final price of that product that goes into the market and how this is potentially captured by the different actors that are in this value chain, which means that do different things. So if I'm a company that is designing the new Apple type of shape or whatever, the new iPad shape, and I'm the company in China who is doing the production of that, let's say this is a very short chain, right? Let's have just two actors. The final product, the value of that final product that is going to be in the market is going to be split by these actors, right? Because they're doing different components of that. So it's in a very rough, general way, just to convey the message, this is how it is, right? How it is represented. The reality is much more complex than that, because you might say that there are different ways of thinking what value is, right? You can think about the value chain in terms of employment, in terms of tax contribution, in terms of many other dimensions that are not related just to the firm perspective. All this literature has started from the point of view of the company who wants to enter to a certain niche in the world production of certain products and want to be able to extract value out of that, okay? What is your I mean, the other concept of value we're thinking of?
Well, for the user, for example, like what kind of value the product has, or like what kind of value the brand has.
Yeah.
So, like, I was trying to understand what you actually mean by value.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's my question.
Yeah. Okay. So the fundamental issue here I'm trying to convey is that when we think about our sectoral value chain, more or less represented in this way, with all the modification I was saying, which means knowing that actually this is a quite rough representation, and in many industries there might be peaks here, which means there might be manufacturing activities or design activities that have much more value than the innovation part. If you think about something like this, then we can try to map quite a lot of this value chain, and we can try to see how different sectors work. And indeed, this is what I was saying before, this has been done recently by various economists. In particular, this is an economist, a Japanese economist, who has been trying to basically saying, I want to go beyond the stylization that we have, and I want to try to see if in different industries, for example, I just reported two, electronics and motor vehicles, the standard Smiling-Couve representation reflect where value is concentrated, right? So he's been doing what I was mentioning to you. He's been taking the final product, he's been looking at the different countries and companies producing that, and where part of that value was remaining, right? Yeah.
We're talking about values and there's a part called value creation.
Yeah.
So what do you mean by actually value creation? I mean, like, how do you actually create value of any service or product or anything?
Yeah. So the fact that you are able to produce a certain type of component that are entering a final product, right, allows you to have a product that fundamentally is evaluated by the market, right? And the value of that product, so the capacity that you have to sell that product at a certain price, is the value that you have generated, that you have created, right? Of course, there are certain type of innovation that allow to have more value creation type of possibilities, because if you are able to contribute to one of these new technologies where the final product and the market loves this technology, think about, you know, smartphone or this typical type of things, or sophisticated technology, production technologies, right? Machinery, machine tools, and so on. Well, then you are able to create a part of the value of the final product, which is the machine, and you are able basically to use that value that is created to potentially make new investment in the second round of innovation around that component that you originally produced. Okay? So it's in a way, it's an expression. I mean, the literature on global value chain and so on, and I'm pleased that you're raising this issue, it's quite ambiguous in this respect, because it's been basically coming out from a business literature which has been trying to give a sense of what was changing when, starting from the 70s, 80s, and so on, with globalization, multinationals were starting having that process I was referring to, or vertical disintegration, where producers of cars were, you know, creating huge value chains, and were producing components of the cars in different parts. Think about one of the, again, we go to aerospace, you know, the Dreamliner, one of the last Boeing big airplane, right? That was, I think, produced, I don't remember the exact number, I think 18 countries. Italy was involved as well. I think we were doing some stabilizer for the for all the architecture of the airplane. So that was basically a huge value chain around a specific product, each country with a specific companies, because these are industries which are extremely concentrated, right? When we talk about aerospace in the UK, we talk about Rolls-Royce, right? Not talking about, and then of course the filière around that. And think about the Dreamliner. The Dreamliner, I think all the countries were developed countries. China still is not able to enter into that type of industry because the technologies that require are pretty sophisticated and they require a certain combination they cannot do still. They are making lots of effort and investment in trying to enter into that. But we're the usual countries, Japan, US, Germany, Italy, and so on and so forth. Okay? Yeah.
Would you want to make a concrete example of value? One.
Okay. So for example, if you have we are going to now enter into the medical device example case study I was giving you. So an hemodialysis machine, you know what is an hemodialysis machine? So a machine that basically filter your blood when you have basically impurities. So a machine that has to do this operation, right, needs inside, and I will show you exactly how it looks, the architecture of the products, a specific membrane which filters the blood. Okay? Now, to produce that in the standard machine that we were looking at in this cluster, I was able to understand what was the cost of that specific component. So each machine, in each machine, the cost of that was almost one-third, was 30% something. Which means that the final value of that machine, the final price of that machine, was actually, the company that was selling that, was paying another company, in this case a German company, to have that membrane. So the 30% of the final value and price of that product was actually coming from that specific subcomponent, which was basically the one that was doing a very important part of that. Okay? And then there were other parts of that machine, which were valves and pumps and embedded software and tubes and so on, which had each of them different components, right? And all of them were produced by different companies, right? So the total product, the final system products, and it will be clear now that I'm going to show you the architecture, has different names of companies, right, around them. But here the point is more that the story around value creation in this value chain is very complex because it involves different sectors in different ways, which means that in some sectors, as I was saying before, you may have complex activities at the level of manufacturing, some others in the level of design, some others in the level of the downstream type of activities, and so on and so forth. Okay, so now let me ask you to help me, actually, because we enter into the realm of where economists really don't know what they're talking about. And the third element that I was mentioning already is that the majority of the new complex products are based on very complex system of technologies, right? I'm going to show you how Gregory Tassé, who is sort of half economist engineer, has been trying to synthesize or make a sense of these varieties of technologies. So he's basically, again, starting from the idea that there is a sectoral value chain. This is a very short, simple one. And as you see, use the expression of value added and value addition in the sense I was referring before. And in order to get these activities going, in order to get these activities going, each phase of activity require a specific type of technology. So what engineers, what are the classification or type of taxonomies that engineers would use to distinguish different type of technologies? For example, what could be the difference between a technology platform from an infra technology or from other type of technologies? Because this is also a matter of language, and we are discussing this morning about the difficulties that there are between policymakers, economists, engineers, technologists to understand each other, because there is no common language that can be used to explain a phenomenon that actually involves these different dimensions, right? Because what we've been talking so far are markets, are companies, are policymakers, government, technologies, what's happening in the lab, what's happening in the innovation, and so on and so forth. This guy, Gregory Tassé, tried exactly to develop a sort of common language to actually help the dialogue between these different stakeholders and come out with a classification that allowed to a certain extent to give more justice of a simple expression technology as a black box. So what he did was, I'm drawing from some of his paper, one of the last published in the Journal of Economic Perspectives, where he basically says, look, if we want to start opening this black box, we have to think about the science base, where all basic R&D activities are done, basic research is conducted. And then we have to think about the fact that there are a number of generic technologies or platform technologies that are actually those that are used in a plurality of sectors on which we build quite a lot of different products, right? Many of these technologies are, to a certain extent, publicly available in the sense that they become the platform for the entire sector that operate in that activity, right? On top of that, there are then a number of technologies that become proprietary technologies because the company says, I'm in the smartphone industry, right? And I'm going to, like in the case of the last Samsung, right? The last Galaxy model, what they did, they basically built on an architecture of a smartphone that is common to the entire industry, right? Actually, they have usually quite a lot of disputes around who actually contributed the most to the creation of that, or patents type of disputes, right? But on top of that, they put some specific proprietary technology, which means some specific patents around the number of innovation that they did. And the last one was what? This new fancy screen, right? With the curves on the side, right? Which allows to perceive the image on the phone in a different way, right? On the other side, they were, of course, trying to do similar things, right? I mean, the introduction of, again, in the screens of the iPad, of the Retina screen, and so on and so forth, right? There are then a number of technologies that actually are not sold as part of the product, but actually they are critical for making innovation possible. And these are what, in his framework, called infra technologies. So all the time you want to develop a product, you build on a set of platform generating technologies that are shared in that sector value chain. You try to develop specific characteristics of that product so that your product is going to be the iPhone, is going to be the Galaxy, is going to be something else, right? So distinctive characteristics and functionality of that product. But in doing all this activity, you need lots of infra technologies, which means lots of technologies that provide infrastructure whereby this new product is produced. Think about, for doing standardization of products or standardization at the beginning of the innovation process and so on, you need to have equipment, instrumentation. Think about the metrology systems, right? Measurement. All these type of things are critical for bridging the first basic research activities to the creation of generic platform technologies and the exploitation of these technologies in terms of new products that are proprietary technology. Okay? And of course, all these things are providing different fundamental functions. There is an entrepreneurial activity that is happening here, and there is a specific risk reduction activity that is happening at the level of the infra technologies, right? When in a certain sector there are certain standards, there are certain type of tools that are used in order to gather information about the product, so measurement test methods for R&D, production control, technical support for interface standards, and so on and so forth. All these scientific database, all these things are used by companies in order to move in this stage of technological innovation from the basic research to the creation of these platform technologies and the creation of different variety of products there. Okay? So this is a quite, at least in the economic realm, has been quite an advancement. Why? Because it's been basically suggesting that all the time we think about an economic system and this manufacturing ecosystem, we cannot just think if they are innovative or not. They might be more innovative on one side, the other side, or whatever, right? They might be actually doing different things, right? So in the UK, for example, what they say, we are very good here, right? And actually, we have very good results in terms of patenting. But then it seems that they are pretty bad in doing other things, right? So there are very few companies that are actually manufacturing products, commercializing these ideas, this innovation, and putting them into the market. And there are other countries, let's say, for example, Germany, where tomorrow we will see there are very specific type of institutions in the manufacturing system that provides infra technologies. These are called Fraunhofer's, for example. Have you ever heard about Fraunhofer's? Actually, they employ quite a lot of also Italian engineers, I must say. I've been working last summer in Berlin and a few other areas around on them. So if you search on the web, if you search for Fraunhofer's, you see that there is a huge network of technology institutes that are sectorally and technology specific that work with companies providing lots of these activities and lots of scaling up activities. I think they contributed also to the MP3 technology. They did quite a lot of things. This is another, we'll see tomorrow, another of those actors that contribute to this story. But I'm making this example just to say that this type of way of efforts to analytically understand different type of technologies, how the process works, the different actors, the structure, and so on, are quite important, not just from an academic perspective, but also from developing heuristics, tools that allow us to distinguish different systems, understand where there are their strengths, where there are their weaknesses, and where potentially it's possible to intervene to improve the condition. Let me accelerate a bit because otherwise I will not be able to cover everything. This discussion indeed is becoming very important in terms of distinguishing different types of technologies, how they contribute to innovation and so on, also in Europe. For those of you following the discussion on the work that the high-level group on Kinebly technology has been doing since 2010, has been basically trying to look at new ways of thinking about technological system innovation and thinking about those key enabling technologies that would allow the next manufacturing advanced system to develop over time. And they focused on nanotechnologies, micro and nanoelectronics, photonics, advanced material, industrial biotechnology, and advanced manufacturing systems. These things have been then studied, and now we are starting having the first numbers, which tells us what are the countries who are making more production and investment in this type of new technologies. This is coming from a chapter I wrote for a book which was organized for an event organized by the National Academy last October. The way in which they define these cats are knowledgeable and capital-intensive technologies associated with high research and development intensity, rapid and integrated innovation cycles, high capital expenditure, and highly skilled employment. So very much the type of examples we've been discussing so far, right? Or at least we've been discussing products that build on some of these technologies. And if you look at the report I was giving you, they actually go through different sectoral value chain, they look at the final product, and they try to see at each stage of the chain what are the key technologies that are actually supporting this production. Okay, let me now give you the last two elements that we should consider when we look at these innovation dynamics. One is that, as I was mentioning before, we are increasingly having cross-sectoral innovation, which means, as I was saying before, that there is a company which operates across sectors. And secondly, that in this system, not all the companies are the same, and there are opportunities to capture value out of the activities, which means get a big share of that final price of the product, depends on the role that you have in that system. So let me use a case to explain this type of dynamics. So the Emilia-Romagna region is a techno-industrial manufacturing ecosystem that has been developing quite a number of sophisticated districts and sectoral value chains. Where is the Lamborghini made? Well, Ferrari, Ducati. It seems they are good with machine and this type of things, right? Lots of the machine tool production, you know, I'll give you just a number. This is probably has to be updated. It was a couple of years ago. The production of machine tools in all Europe and north of Africa, the 51% was produced by two countries, Germany and Italy. Germany 30-something percent, Italy 20%. If you look at what regions in Italy are contributing most to the production of machine tools, and as you know, machine tools are the machines of the machines, right? The machines of those type of production technologies that allow you to do quite a lot of stuff. Many of those are actually produced in this region. So they're quite good with machine, they're quite good with sophisticated machine that today include quite a lot of electronics, embedded softwares, and so on to control them. And they are very good also in materials. Some people use the expression, this is the plastic valley. It's very difficult to know how they manage over the years to do that. There are different theories, but the fact that they produce cars, for many years, cars had lots of components that were made with plastics, right? So in other terms, they had to develop over the years advanced knowledge in specific type of materials because in many of the products they were producing, there was lots of demand for that, okay? So when I try to understand what is happening here, I just try to start with all the economists would do, which means I went to the regional government, I tried to see what is happening in terms of the data that are there for each company and so on. But even the government was like, we really don't know too much about this ecosystem because there are so many overlaps between all these value chains that we don't know if the innovation is coming from the medical device sectors or from the automotive sectors, who made first the investment in plastics, who made or in certain type of new technologies, who is actually driving all this new investment in embedded software. They really don't know. So the point is, try to find an entry point in this manufacturing ecosystem, and for us was, let me go quickly, was this specific machine here, which is the hemodialysis machine I was referring before. This is the architecture of that machine. As I said, there is a place where the blood goes through this membrane that basically filters that. But it's not so simple, right? Because you are extracting basically biological material from an individual. You have to do that in a certain controlled way. You need to have proper valves, pumps that control of it. And you need to have tubes which are plastic tubes, but are quite particular type of plastic. And indeed, they managed to become so good in doing this that the Emilia-Romagna region is one of the leaders in doing microtubing. So very small tubes that to be produced required injection molding technologies, so the production technologies that allow you to process the plastics, the polymers, which are very, very sophisticated. So the issue is, what is happening in this area? Well, they started becoming more and more good in doing these machines, and they started developing in the region competencies around this different set of technologies. So around control systems, around filtration technologies, fluid system, and so on and so forth. And what they did was, this is just a sample from the many companies we visited, they started basically working on their core technologies, developing specific production technologies to work on them, but at the same time they started identifying, these are all companies which were identified through the major companies in the area as important contractors and specialist contractors. Okay? So what we realized is that many of these companies were working in all these areas that were basically critical for the medical device sectors and producing innovation of these types, but in reality they were capturing lots of product opportunities across sectors, which means they were working at the same time in pharma, bioagriculture, automotive, aerospace, chemicals, biomedicals, and so on and so forth. So they were basically expanding, diversifying, and the direction of innovation, if you want, the vectors of innovation, were cutting across all these different sectors, which means that sometimes there was more demand, for example, for microtubing in the sophisticated product, which was the medical device machine, and these technologies were then mutated by fast cars and used in another industry. Okay? So fundamentally, we have dynamics that make the story of innovation much more complex than we used to think in the past. In a stylized form, I'm using here a representation that was used by Sturgeon in a paper, Industrial and Corporate Change, a few years ago. But the fundamental point here is you have different value chains organized in different ways. You have the biomedical value chains, and then you have a number of companies, like the one I was showing before, that actually what they do, they have constantly operate at the border, if you want, at the interface between this sectoral value chain, this world of biomedical devices, and they actually try to gather information, technologies from other sectors, they apply medical, biomedical devices, at the same time they apply to other sectors. Okay? So it's a much more complex set of innovation than the one that think about, you know, one company working for one big system drivers, developing one technologies and then nothing else. Actually, technology is really about all these interdependencies. And then the issue is, okay, so when we learned how that system was working, we try to say, let's try to reconstruct the system in a systematic way, which means let's try to see each specific actors involved, each specific sector of type of technologies and so on. So we end up basically looking at the specific value chain for these medical devices. These are the specific functions that were performed at each stage of the value chain. We're looking at each actor and in what stages of the value chains that they were operating. So there were some that were operating just upstream, some others that were operating more downstream, the system integrators, so the multinationals, we're operating across all of them. By the way, this is an area which is, if you are in Modena, you take a small road and you end up in, after 30 kilometers, in this cluster, right? And there is a company like the Swedish company Gambro who moved even their fully robotized distribution center there. The funny thing is that to enter in the distribution center is a small road. You almost, you know, fell on the side of the road, right? And someone would immediately say, why they have been coming here? What the hell? Well, what's the point? And the point that you will realize is that this multinational will tell you that in order to do one of these specific functions, there is no other place in Europe where you can find that specific small medium enterprise that does that properly well. Or it's very difficult to find those guys who are able to do that specific innovation at the level of the component that they need, and so on and so forth. Okay? So this is a just to give you an example of the complexity when we talk about manufacturing system and innovation or what is really happening out there. And this is just one example. Think about the fact that there are plenty of this manufacturing system around many of the complex products we look around. And just to convince you that the classification that Tasse gave us is quite useful, here we try to put together all the different type of technologies that we're finding and trying to expand even this idea, trying to open this issue of proprietary technologies and looking also at the production technologies that we're using and the type of infra technologies that were relevant there. I'm almost done because the last part was not meant to be a real part of the lecture, because actually I'm building on something that is publicly available, and actually I will use part of that also tomorrow, which is basically the way in which in economics, but in general in the academia and war manufacturing industry, at the global level, people have been trying to look at all these dynamics and trying to find indicators to come out with the benchmarking tools, which says, well, given all these things that are happening, there are certain countries who are doing better than others. And in particular, I was involved over the last few years in working with UNIDO, with the United Nations Industrial Development Organization, in designing an industrial competitiveness index and validating one that they were already using. Okay? You are all familiar with World Economic Forum? How many of you? World Economic Forum? Never heard? Okay. This is the one that work with the World Bank in producing something called Doing Business Report. No? Never? Okay, I think so. Probably I will re-mention these things tomorrow, because I think it's quite important to get a sense for you of the type of discussion that is happening at the level of international organization and forum that are actually trying to come out with reports analysis that in relatively simple indexes try to synthesize what we've been discussing so far. And why I'm saying this, not just because it's interesting from a policy angle or global perspective, but it's interesting for companies as well. Because many manufacturing and innovative companies look at this report to get a sense of how simple it is to start a company or an activity in South Africa, how difficult it might be to move a production facility in Vietnam, and so on and so forth, right? So this global type of perspective is actually quite interesting for companies to orientate their strategic decision and where the next round of innovation can actually happen, okay? So the idea is for tomorrow to build on some of these issues we discussed and try to go more in the direction of thinking, well, there is a big player in this story, which is the government, and the government has been playing historically a major role in boosting innovation. Probably some of you read the recent book by Mariana Mazzucato, The Entrepreneurial State, or at least saw her in some TV talk show or something like that. But we have increasing evidence that the government has played in the past and can play an important entrepreneurial role. So tomorrow the point is going to be, is it this happening? Why is happening? And to what extent actually innovation is affected by that? And what are the different models that in different countries are used to boost innovation from the public perspective? What type of institution, what type of financial infrastructure is supporting that, and so on and so forth.